IVM.
Hello and welcome to Simplified, the weekly-ish podcast with your four hosts. And very clearly, we don't have an intro written out for this. So I don't even have the standard question that we ask anybody. So we should, Sriketh, I think what we should do is we should whip
I
up
have a profundity.
Yes, exactly. We should do that. Long-time listeners will know that when we fall short of content at the beginning of an episode, we normally turn to our family WhatsApp groups to unearth the gems flowing with pearls of wisdom. Or rather, we scuba dive into the murky waters that are our family WhatsApp group.
Oh my God.
Put our hand inside the oysters of forwards and extract the shimmering pearls that are the profundity of the day. And if any of you watch Stephen Colbert, you will know that this is an inspiration from the Meanwhile segment. If you don't,
modem tod de.
Modem tod de is now coming to a t-shirt near you. It will be available on merch.simplified.cz because we are based out of Czech Republic for tax reasons. Sriketh, please go ahead.
Okay, some forward for which some modem should have been broken before it came. Also linking to internet connectivity, which starts hence.
Yeah.
Son, it's a dialogue between father and son. Mm-hmm. Son says, Papa, how you survived without 4G and 5G during your time? Father, during our time, there used to be 3G. That is Mataji, Pitaji and Guruji.
Oh my God.
Hang on. With one slap from them, our whole network got activated automatically.
Wow.
Yeah, this is, it's almost literal punching down with humor.
Oh, how do you go
forward from there? Beautiful.
Thank you, Sriketh, for that pearl of wisdom which shall be worn on the necklace of shame. I don't know where this is going.
Very nice.
Okay, today there is no possible segue from that to what we are going to talk about.
No, it's a universal truth, so.
And it's a basic truth.
That's correct.
And after
it's
this,
not giving anyone any income.
Income, correct. So, on that note, Tony, we can talk about universal basic income, which is UBI. Wow, that is an awkward segue. But we shall walk that segue if you get that one as well. So, UBI is a topic that I have been interested in for a while. I think it's generally a nice idea. And it's become popular of late thanks to American presidential candidate Andrew Yang, who ran on a platform of giving everybody in the country $1,000. With which they can do, whatever they want.
Okay. We've got 15 lakhs each.
Now we got 15 lakhs. Correct. Yeah. That is universal acidic income. Because, vitriol and all that. Vitriol, as you know, is linked. Vitriol is derived from vitrium, which is the same root word of sulfuric acid. So
it's like
it literally is
alcohol
acid
made with. Because all is there, no?
All? What?
Oh, God.
Never mind.
Oh, no. Oh, God. Where are we going with this, Sriketh?
I really don't know. This is why they should give.
Just imagine if they give out UBI, then more people like us will come to studios and record nonsense. Better to make everybody sit and work only. Okay. Universal basic income. We will talk a little bit about it, the history about it, and whether it's a good idea or a bad idea, because that's something that the whole world is debating right now. It's come to prominence recently because of, whatever happens in the US presidential elections, everybody around the world hears. So actually, my interest with UBI in a way started in this studio itself. Naren, me and Amit Doshi, who runs IVM, we were just sitting and talking about the US elections for some reason. And I did not read too much about the candidates at that point of time. And I just generally like whatever Elizabeth Warren was saying. So I said, yeah, I think I would support her if I was voting. And both Naren and Amit, being more sagacious than me and gray-haired than me, or hair than me.
Yeah, you can make that joke. We
I asked Amit who he would pick, and he thought for a while and he said Andrew Yang, and that's not an answer that I expected to hear, because, you know, the fringe candidates aren't somebody who you expected to hear. But when I went back and I read about his policies and stuff, it actually seemed very interesting. It was very clear he was never going to win, but some of the ideas that he put forward, especially his proposal to give every American $1,000, I think was pretty interesting. I can't say whether it's a good idea or a bad idea, and I will take your opinion on that.
So we'll discuss the yin and the yang.
Sriken, I warned you about this.
In my defense, I googled UBI and got Union Bank of India.
Okay. So universal basic income is basically if a country or a region, like a state or a village or whatever it is, gives all its residents or citizens a fixed amount of money every month or every year, no questions asked. And that's the important thing. It's universal in the sense that the poorest person and the richest person will get it.
Everyone gets it.
That's the important thing about universal basic income. It's given to everybody regardless of...
Doesn't matter if you work or not.
Yeah, it doesn't matter if you're working or not. Doesn't matter if you're rich or poor. Doesn't matter if you're black or white. You're still... Oh, wait, that's a Michael Jackson song. So it's really universal in that sense. There are some models that say, okay, the top 25% can opt out of it. Some models that go more further and say if those 25% don't opt out of it, their names will be published and public shame will have. So, yeah... It gets confusing, but at its simplest, everybody gets a fixed amount of money.
Okay.
And importantly, they are free to do what they want with it. Now, they can blow it all on booze if they want, or they can use it for, you know, actual necessities like food, healthcare, or whatever it is.
Okay.
So those are the two important things about UBI in any form. Any dilution of this in some form brings in a couple of things. One, it brings in some amount of welfareism. Which is like, for example, what NREGA is doing over here, where you have identified a certain set of people and say we will give them X amount of money.
Correct.
So it brings in some amount of, you know, some aspect of welfareism. And second, it brings with it some level of bureaucracy.
Okay. So who gets included? Who doesn't?
So just to figure out who this 25% is or 10% is or whatever, there is some amount of bureaucracy.
Okay.
With universal basic income coming in, one of the big arguments is that all the bureaucracy to figure that out goes away.
Oh.
And you end up saving a lot of money, and that saving itself will fund part of UBI.
Okay.
So this is the first simplified episode that I've actually scribbled down notes. Okay. In case, before they used to be typed out. I'm not even bothering to take that much effort. I call it spontaneous evolution.
Very nice.
You can choose to call it laziness. Shriket is... I can't see him, but my assumption is his head is in his hands thinking, why did I say yes when he asked me whether I want to be a guest on the show?
So this simplified episode is pay-per-view.
Oh, God. I think everyone should evacuate right now.
Okay. One other aspect of universal basic income is the amount itself that is given, right? So right now, $1,000 a month in the US is the popular amount because, you know, it's a nice round number, and also it's because it's the US. It's all in many countries is calculated as your minimum subsistence amount. How much you need to just survive.
Right.
It won't be more than that. It won't be money. It's basically money to get you out of middle class. It's basically money to get you out of poverty.
Right.
It will not be money to get you into the middle class, because, you know, then you're starting to spend on discretionary expenses, which the state and other taxpayers don't need to fund.
Right.
So in some countries, they also call it minimum subsistence amount or something like that. In the US, they've tried to rebrand it. US being the fucking US, they try to rebrand it, calling it freedom dividend and things like that.
Whoa.
I think so. Yeah, that's, I think, what Andrew, I think that was what Yang had called it, the freedom dividend or something. And they had considered some other terms, and this apparently went well with focus groups. So white people.
What were the other options?
I really don't know. You know, one interesting thing about UBI is that it theoretically has support across the political spectrum. On one end, if you take libertarians, and I'm talking about classic spectrum, not the whole nationalism nonsense that's happening right now, at the theoretical right end, which is libertarians, they're happy because you get money and you can do whatever you want with it. They are super pro-choice, whatever it is, so you can do whatever you want with this. And on the other side of things, you have connotations that the state is making everybody happy or whatever it is. So it has aspects of welfare and socialism built into it as well. So that way it should have bipartisan support. But in this day and age, bipartisan means something totally different. This also means that the free market remains largely intact, which is another good thing that comes out of UBI. So I'm just going to read out random notes. You guys can just chime in with whatever you think. Why did you laugh, Da? Tell.
Also the tagline of Simblified.
That one's going to stick. This one is going to stick. Okay. Whatever studies have happened on... firstly, UBI is not a completely new concept. It was theorized by some, some of these jobless philosophers back in the day in Netherlands and all that. Because they had time to do it.
But no income there. What have we got income for thinking about things?
Strangely enough, even somebody as pro-market as Milton Friedman... espoused it in some way when he spoke about this thing called negative income tax.
Okay.
If you remember, if you are below a certain income level, then you will actually get money. So it wasn't UBI in its purest form, but it's the closest, I suppose, to what a class, those free market economists have endorsed.
Does it exist anywhere in the world?
Yeah, so it doesn't exist. There have been various experiments that have happened in several parts, and I'll tell you whichever experiments I could find. Long story short, whatever experiments have happened have turned out to be largely successful, in the sense lives have gotten better and, all that. And this has happened in a few places. I'll get to details of where all that's happened, including in India. But the one big, big problem is, unlike many other trial programs and random control trials or whatever it is, over here there is always there are two problems over here. One, the people who are being given UBI know that it's not going to last forever, right? So there is you will get this amount for only 1 year or 10.
Why? Because the experiment period.
Because it's an experiment, right? You can't fund UBI forever. So they will always be on the back of this mind, and they will calculate accordingly, knowing that, so this is extra money. I'm going to keep it with me.
Okay.
And while there were some positive outcomes as a result of that, they will also account for the fact that this money won't last forever. So that is problem one. Problem two is it's difficult to extrapolate this to the whole country, because there's a huge difference between some people having universal basic income and the entire country having universal basic income. Because many of the outcomes that UBI is going to give, which is better healthcare, better economic, whatever it is, all those advantages, will come about only if the entire country has UBI and not if only a certain selected set of them have it.
Okay.
Unlike, say, a medical trial, which you can still extrapolate to some extent, because this is something that's so interdependent on each other, right? Those are some of the challenges. So people are still trying to figure out how to now take... because whatever research has happened, and some have happened at a reasonable amount of scale, entire villages, cities to some extent, they have all been successful. I think the next challenge is, okay, now how do we actually... take it. And if you look at all the arguments around this that are there on the internet, broadly what people agree is you need to now take this to a country level. Otherwise, there is no way of seeing whether this will work or not.
Okay.
But that
also means so much expenditure.
Expenditure. Right? So we will now get into that. Oh, now this is
the income and the outcome.
Yeah. Okay. Firstly, one of the biggest criticisms for UBI is that people will, poor people, the beneficiaries, will spend it on booze and drugs.
Yeah.
One that smacks of people who are sitting in air-conditioned towers trying to make decisions for the rest of us.
Correct.
And strange enough, that's proven not to be the case. Every study on UBI that has happened, there was one famous one in Finland. There are a few that happened in Madhya Pradesh, I think, in Madhya Pradesh in India. And a couple in other places like South, I think there was in South Africa and the US as well. Everywhere it's shown that the poor has actually ended up spending less on booze and drugs.
Oh, wow.
Purely because they do all that to escape from attention or whatever, right?
Correct.
On the other hand, rich people have actually spent more on booze and drugs because for them it's more about
It's
a discretionary expense, right? Yeah. So they end up ironically spending more than so that one argument that poor people will flicker away the money, that's totally and that's markets from Finland to Madhya Pradesh. So I think that's as wide a spectrum as you can think of. Another worry is that people will just stop working. If you give everyone money, then everyone will stop working. So again, all studies have proven that that's not going to happen. When they did this in Canada as far back as 1970, only 1% of people actually stopped working. And when researchers dug deeper into that, that is because they chose to stay home to take care of their kids.
Oh, okay.
Which, if you listen to recent episodes of Freakonomics and things like that, people will argue that actually adds more to value, even though it's not calculated in this GDP like thing. Many people, many critics again have said, okay, a lot of what UBI does is just state sponsored welfare. So why not just call it welfare and, make schemes out of it?
Uh-huh.
So one, welfare usually comes with a lot of strings that are attached. You need to qualify under 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 things before you get some sort of welfare. Two, there is a lot of time and bureaucracy that is involved in making whatever welfare is happening right now. And the recent, I think that those snags that MNREGA is going through is a good example of that. The third thing is, one of the criticisms of UBI is that it will potentially reward passive behavior, as in people will just want to stay home and not work.
Correct.
But that is more true of welfare in some situations, because what happens is, suppose for example, $1,000 a month is your welfare amount. If you earn anything over that amount, your whole welfare is taken away. So now what will happen is, if you have a job that pays you $1, now suddenly your $1,000 is taken away.
Correct.
So you are worse off than a person who is unemployed.
Correct.
So there are problems like this. So, those issues are also so then how do you account for stuff like that? At what point do you take the welfare away? So all these things put together, it turns out that it's actually the best summation of UBI that I heard was it's a floor and not a ceiling. So basically it gives you enough to just get on with get on doing other things in your life. And it's not really a cap that you will, this is the maximum that you will go to and stuff like that, which I thought was really interesting. Like I had self-aware moment once when I realized that my housemate didn't have medical income. Medical insurance.
Huh.
And I was if something happens to me, for instance, I have my medical insurance to take care of that, because I could afford a 5,000 buck insurance to make sure that I don't have to pay a 5 lakh operation fee. But she doesn't have that. So she will potentially have to pay a lot more. So, that was when my interest in UBI started, I started reading up more about it. And I just thought it'd be very nice if everybody just had enough to cover their basic shit. So they don't have to worry about eating. They didn't have to worry about living, and they didn't have to worry about stuff like this. And then that's exactly what UBI is. We will discuss more of this on the other side of this break, where we have a surprise for you.
Hey, everybody. Welcome to another amazing week on the IVM Podcast Network. If you're not following us on social media, please do. We're IVM Podcast on Twitter, Facebook, and Instagram. We'd like to thank our sponsors this week, Paytm Money and HDFC Life. Remember, sponsors make these shows possible. Do show them your appreciation. And if you own a brand or work for a brand or are associated a brand and think that that brand would benefit from working with IVM, do reach out to us. You can find contact information on our website. Also, just a very quick note, I would really appreciate it if you guys could fill out a really short survey on our website. It's on ivmpodcast.com/survey. It's just a brand recognition survey for us to kind of work with the advertisers and give them some data. So it's a very short, less than 1 minute survey. Really appreciate your help in filling it out. So people, we have a new show releasing this week. It's called Begin the Journey. It's hosted by national award-winning film actor and motivational speaker Ashish Vidyarthi. He shares inspiring stories from various aspects of life. Stay tuned. First episode comes out on Monday, the 2nd of March. On Advertising is Dead, Varun does another AMA episode where he answers some questions sent in by listeners about advertising and content. He also gets some of his previous guests to give their takes on the questions. On Cyrus Says, Cyrus is joined by Lakshmi Krishnan, host of Lit Nama, to talk about her show and her love for literature. Also, check out Cock and Bull, which came out on Thursday last week. Cyrus is joined by Rohan Gujral, myself, and Silvery. We discuss Donald Trump's visit to India, we debate broccoli samosas, and discuss the case of a crocodile in Mulund. Also, if you haven't been doing it, please do send AMA questions for Cyrus and Varun's shows. Every episode of Cyrus has an AMA segment, and Advertising is Dead is going to have one once a month. On IVM Likes, Ritika, Radhika, and Antriksh are joined by the co-host of the Edges and Sledges cricket podcast, Dhananjay Chuck. They talk about the T20 Women's World Cup and discuss movies which portray women in sports. On The Habit Coach, Ashton talks about the best way to work on your hands and exercise them. On Edges and Sledges, DJ Ashwin and Varun talk about India's great run at the T20 Women's World Cup and the New Zealand versus India test. On Ganatantra, Saryu and Alok are joined by Rahul Verma of the Center for Policy Research. They discuss how Indian voters vote along the lines of ideology and identity. On the Empowering series, Zarina is joined by Khushbu Benani. She is the content and marketing lead at Diageo India, and they talk about storytelling with brands. On Lit Nama, Lakshmi is joined by the musician Ritviz and his artist manager Rahul Sinha. They talk about coming-of-age music and their albums. And with that, let's get you back to your show.
Hello and welcome back to Simplified, and we have a surprise for you. We are launching our own cryptocurrency, and this is called Simplified Coin. the surprise is, many people have asked us whether, one, Naren is real, and two, whether Shriketh is actually an algorithm. which we have programmed very well to make some very fine lines. And some people have even asked us whether they're the same person who is played by one voice actor. Actually, nobody has ever asked us any of these questions. The fact of the matter is, Shriketh had to leave because a little emergency came up, which did not involve the bathroom, I assure you. But what we have lost in a Shriketh, we have gained in a Naren who has randomly landed up in the studio. Hi.
Hello.
Hi, and welcome to Simplified, I suppose.
Thanks. Dear listeners, sorry for being late. Or maybe not, actually, because you would have had a much better podcast to like it. But
interestingly, normally in an episode, only listeners leave us. So imagine the quality of this episode
if a host had to leave.
So I'm not sure who you're talking to at this point.
Anyway, Naren, before you came in, we were talking about the basics of universal basic income, talking about how it is universal, how it is basic, and how it is income. We will now carry on with that, and we were talking about some of the benefits and how it is different from welfare.
Yeah.
Which are two very different things. Okay, Tony, to answer your question, which is where this money could possibly come from. One, of course, if you cut all the, it depends on a lot of things. It depends on how much welfareism is already there in a country, like in Scandinavia, for instance, where the government already spends a fair bit on public health and education.
Right.
It also depends on what the country's values are in terms of what they would prioritize, what they will want to cut, how comfortable they will be with defense cuts, for instance.
Right.
How much they would value education over everything else. So it's kind of complicated math. And of course, the one easy way is just raising taxes on the very rich.
Oh, and then giving it back to them.
And then, so that way it is redistribution, which is again why a lot of people on the left side of the spectrum like that idea. Even though, strangely enough, only one candidate has actually espoused it. Like, both guys who are on the left side of the spectrum, like both Warren and Sanders, really haven't spoken out that they want UBI, maybe because all their ideas are, as it is, too radical.
It's like Kejriwal not talking about it's that radical, no? I mean, in the US, I think not something that can fly in the current context.
So, like I said, all the experiments have so far have been positive. It's also calculated that with the UBI of $1,000 a month in the US, it'll lead to a 12% GDP growth over 8 years. And that's the United States that we're talking about. So it's calculated that that will happen. Okay. Because, see, essentially what will happen is this. When people are, they have, the, so like I said, it's a floor and not a ceiling, right? So once people have the basic floor, they won't be working to survive. They'll be working for making discretionary amount of money, which will by itself lead to greater demand and things like that. They will also be able to invest time in upskilling themselves. So instead of surviving on a day-to-day basis, they might know that, okay, at least I have a roof over my head and food in my stomach and healthcare to take care of my family. Okay, I will spend the next 1 month getting upskilling course or something, which will possibly lead to a much bigger, better job later.
I think there are enough people in the US who work two shifts to cover their
exactly.
And the biggest problem actually is that all the people on the lowest end of the pyramid, which is the biggest chunk of them, convert their labor into money, right? So that's what they do.
Yeah.
And all the guys above on the in the narrowest, smallest part of the pyramid, sitting right at the top, they convert basically their capital into money. They get return on capital. So the lowest levels need to have somebody who's willing to buy their labor.
Yeah.
And in an increasing number of situations, that labor is becoming less and less sought after.
So exactly, right? Especially
so
with
farm labor
coming,
because harvester combines are doing
it very
in the
well
US.
Put. Yeah.
So what people are worried about in the United States especially is that soon about 90% of the people will not have any source of income at all.
Yeah.
Hmm.
And that is going to lead to social unrest.
Correct.
So they are all human beings, so you can't shoot them.
Yeah.
Sadly, you know, it would be best solution actually. Yeah, machine gun like 90. But that doesn't like you. Human
Thanos the benevolent.
Yeah, Thanos. Unfortunately, you can't do Thanos thing. So you have to give them something to spend.
Yeah.
Right? So people have tried subsidies, people have tried free housing, people have tried free meals. All of them have been very, very except in one or two economies like Sweden, which are like total outliers.
Yeah.
Everywhere else in the world, whenever you give them free housing, free food, free
basically when it's restricted, it doesn't work.
It doesn't work. So you need to give people the choice of spending.
And agency.
That's why a lot of people feel that UBI is the only way forward.
Yeah.
And the small like technical point is where is the money
where
going
is the money
from?
Going to
come
from? But it's a long term thing, right? Like if the US's GDP is going to grow up 12% over 8 years, again you need a president or whoever it is to have that sort of long term thinking. What you said, Naren, is perfect. Like is bang on. Like there are studies that have shown that $1 invested in the lowest 10% will give you whatever 30% return or something like that to the entire economy, as opposed to like it gives you just whatever a few cents or something if it's invested on the higher system, because those guys are just going to just going to invest it back into their capital or whatever it is that you know becomes a multiplier for them.
I have a question. Is this is this same as like will it cause inflation if you give money to everyone? Like is it different from printing money?
No, it will. So it is exactly going to it's going to do that. So you'll have a lot of money now chasing presumably the same amount of goods. So prices of everything is going to go up.
Okay.
But usually when that happens, if all the sectors of economy are doing okay, it usually increases production.
Yeah.
So when production increases, inflation comes down again.
A contrarian view to that actually is UBI, at least in its ideal form, involves not making new money, but transfer of money.
Correct.
So that way it won't lead to inflation because it will be the same amount of
money.
No,
it will actually, because the money that they seek to transfer is money that would not have been chasing this goods
fair
otherwise.
Enough. So, fair enough. So correct. Yeah. Again, like I said, there are so many questions. You will actually only know once it's implemented in practice and we actually see what happens. And that too needs to happen.
And universally.
And universally and basically and income-ly. This is other argument that you know, people will not work, which fair enough. I mean, if some people don't want to work, then that's their call.
But you said only like 1% dropped off.
Yeah, but only 1% dropped off. But again, it's about giving people agency, right? Let them do whatever, like let them do whatever they
want. There is an interesting thing here about humans versus other animals, right? So our closest relatives, chimpanzees, right? So researchers studied them and they found, so chimpanzees, one of their few collective activities is hunting for monkeys.
Okay.
So otherwise, basically chimpanzees, they live in groups, but they're basically to themselves. They don't do anything collaboratively humans do.
They're individualistic.
Yeah,
that's why there are no monkey podcasts.
Yeah, that's why.
they're all busy writing the complete works of Shakespeare.
Yeah, so what was I saying? Huh. So they don't collaborate, and on the rare occasion that they do, like they do monkey hunts. Okay, yeah. So like a group of 60, 70 chimpanzees, they'll corner a few monkeys. Mm-hmm. And when the monkeys are cornered, they get caught. So the chimpanzee will catch the monkeys, they'll pound them to death and then start eating them.
Okay.
Right? So...
But like that's not for... Nutrition just...
Nutrition. The chimpanzees are omnivores. So they'll kill monkeys and they'll eat them. And so what researchers found is many individuals, like good 50% of them, basically just hang around watching the fun.
Okay.
And when the kill is made and when they'll go and start pestering the monkey which has the meat... Give me some. And the monkey gives.
Okay.
The chimpanzee gives the monkey meat to the guy, regardless of whether that individual has contributed or not. Right.
Mm.
So they are not able to make that distinction.
Mm. Yeah, even B school professors aren't able to make
that. I don't know about B. But toddlers, it's the same thing with toddlers, and it was completely the other way around.
Oh, okay.
Even toddlers refuse to.
So humans by nature.
So this is something which is behaviorally going to be against UBI. So moment people figure out that somebody is getting money for free that you and I have to work for, even though they are actually getting a pittance and we are getting a lot, it is still going to be a way. So UBI is going to be a very difficult political sell. It's not happened anywhere.
Again, that's the other, the other challenge. You know, the other worry that UBI brings in is that it gives the government, regardless of where their political leanings are, it gives them too much leverage, because suddenly now they control everything. So now it becomes a tool for maybe populists to come in and control tomorrow. So imagine, for example, if there is UBI in India and the next prime minister just comes in and says, I'm going to raise it from whatever, 1,000 rupees a month to 1,500 a month, right? So it
and
becomes
he's not
a,
paying for it, so he just needs to win power.
Yeah, but
he might say even 15 lakhs per person. Who knows?
UBI does have some very notable supporters, right from Martin Luther King to somebody who we spoke about in a few episodes back, Zuck himself, Elon Musk, also Richard Branson.
So, I mean, so, obviously Zuck will do it, no? So people have more time to sit in Facebook.
Yeah. One second.
Yeah, jokes about Dutch.
The other challenge that UBI might bring in, especially if it's there only in one country, is what do you do with immigrants? Like a lot of people might want to go to countries where UBI is there.
Hmm.
For whatever reason, they may work or may not work or whatever it is. So that will create another problem. And the other thing is, if you implement UBI and then you take it away,
that's
going to lead to a lot of stagnation and things like that. So again, a lot of these things have theoretically, the next step is for a country to implement it. There is no other way to see whether this can actually work. The few countries that have done it, some cities in Finland that tried it, or I think it was done for about 100 people or something. And more or less it worked. I think whoever received that amount was able to skill themselves and all that, and they managed to get better jobs later. But the big question, especially what's probably relevant to this episode, is whether this has been tried in India yet. So there has been a trial that happened in Madhya Pradesh in 2009 to 2012, the SEWA, the Self-Employed Women's Association. They did actually a pretty big trial of around, I think, 8 or 10 villages in Madhya Pradesh somewhere. Initially, people, and it focused primarily on women. initially, people were suspicious, like, why is this organization coming and giving away free money? It wasn't that much money also, at least from a Bombay living point of view, which was, I think, around 300 bucks or something per woman per month. Mm. And it was, I think, also 100 rupees for a kid or something. There was some figure like this. Mm. It wasn't a lot, but it was still enough for a lot of people to improve their life. I mean, the markers moved, right? After, I think this was an 18-month experiment. I think the importance of this was the length of time rather than the geographical spread. What improved was health, productivity of people, food security, education. And what reduced was the food deficiency and, strangely enough, the alcohol consumption, which again goes back to the thing we were talking about in the beginning. It's the thing that if you give poor people money, they are going to blow it all on booze. It's, you know, everywhere from Finland to Madhya Pradesh has been disproven. What also increased, interestingly, was people started buying mobiles and motorcycles, but not for entertainment as much as for actual mobility and work. This gave them, again, that thing. It gave them a floor from which they could get on more work and stuff like that.
In fact, this guy's research, the guy who won the recently.
Abhijit Banerjee.
Yeah.
So his research was basically this, that people at the lowest strata, who are like below poverty line, they have aspirations too. So when you give them money, oftentimes, instead of spending it on what they really should be spending it on, such as medicines or good food or anything like that, they would far more likely spend it on things like mobile phones or, you know, smart-looking clothes or whatever.
Yeah.
So he says one of the errors that welfareists fall into is that people are just, the needs are very hierarchical and they're only looking for food and security.
It's linear. It's not linear.
Oh, it's definitely not. In fact, one of the conferences that I went for, there was a researcher from, an Indian researcher who teaches in, I think, Rotterdam. She did a study on, you know, people like this, and these guys are so keen on projecting themselves as what she called fabulous. So, you know, she called it the fabulous billion, fabulous next billion or something like that, which I thought was pretty interesting. I mean, a little away from what you're talking about, but yeah, that's an interesting conversation by itself. It also, the whole thing about UBI also is very relevant for India because we have a famously inefficient welfare delivery system, public
distribution. What are you talking about?
Clearly, you people have not.
I haven't heard of the word bureaucracy in India.
That just shows your elitism and whatever. PDS, ration shops, food rotting away in grains. LIC having to give its profit to Food Corporation of India so that it can rot away 30% of farmers' money. All this, which you people in your ivory towers have not heard of.
to put it simply, is it that UBI works in theory, but it won't win any votes? Is that why it doesn't get implemented?
I don't know if it'll... No,
it'll be... people will be very against it. So
enough welfarism happens in a country like India.
So, welfarism is different.
So, who'll be against
UBI
it?
UBI is very stark and sort of quantifiable.
Okay.
So, no one knows, for example, or no one can really feel the pinch of how much exactly is being spent on Air India, for example.
Correct.
But if you... Well, like divide that total sum by the
and
number of people. Every year, all of us have to pay 300 rupees. Okay. Then it might be.
Okay. Yeah. So again, theoretically it'll work. Wherever trials have happened, it has worked. Like I said again, the next stage is to really take it to
universal.
I mean, ideally, the entire world should implement it together. Only then you'll have like the ideal outcomes. And then you'll have things like immigration.
But personally,
and all that.
I feel that sooner or later is going to happen because of social pressures. See the automation.
Yeah. I think that's the other thing that we haven't spoken about. Sorry,
we still have a few decades to go.
Just before we get into that, the one thing that could happen is Sikkim is planning to implement it across the state. And that should be an interesting test because that's got 700,000 people living over there, which is roughly the population of
the other station
at night. But the other thing is Sikkim is probably the closest to a Nordic country that we have in many ways because it is slightly well off in that sense. Women have a fair amount of agency over there. There's a fair amount of education also. So it will be interesting to see what happens if it gets implemented over there. And of course, something that we haven't spoken about till now. I mean, till now it's all focused on getting the poor out of the above the poverty line. But yes, automation and all that is going to render a lot of people literally jobless in the next decade and all. And that's the reason why Elon Musk and Zuck, I think. Yeah.
So US is going to be the first victim of it.
Mm.
But it's still several decades away, in my opinion, when, you know, by the time...
Climate change will get us.
climate change will get us,
And it'll also be a long time before this level of UBI becomes ubiquitous.
Oh.
Saving the
well place.
Well done.
Couple of other examples, actually. Right now, of course, there's a lot of media attention. One, because of automation, and two, because Andrew Yang came in and said, hey, let's give everyone $1,000. And that also brings with this critique, right? Just like in the last episode when you said the TechCrunch was very quick to react to Facebook's oversight board saying this will never work.
Yeah.
There are equal number of people
in
publications ranging from New York Times to Breitbart saying this UBI nonsense will never work.
Mm.
Strangely enough, there is one Republican-controlled state in the US that actually does something like UBI.
Texas.
No, it's Alaska.
What?
Oh, okay. Yes. It's called the oil dividend. Long back, some Republican governor or in Alaska or whatever the equivalent of chief minister is over there, he had this, you know, fairly...
Sarah Palin is from there.
It was fairly foresightful of him when they struck oil and they became rich very, very quickly. He said, okay, this money is not going to last forever. This should be divided among the people in Alaska. So they have something called an oil dividend every year, which varies according to the amount of oil that's actually sold. So everybody in Alaska actually gets a cut out of it. So that's actually the closest thing that we have to some form of UBI. But it's still not, you know, exact because the amount varies. It's a bunch of things.
And it's not a UBI.
It's the closest thing to that that we have. But yeah, here's hoping that there is a world where... I don't know whether it'll be a good thing or a bad thing. I think it's something that...
UBI will be good. I'm of the pro-UBI camp.
The pro-UBI camp.
By definition, it has to be very, very, very meager.
Yeah,
so you can't have like $1 million.
Yeah. So just to get another perspective, so like whichever article or video I read on UBI was... Obviously, very pro, but that's also a reflection of the type of media and the outlets that I consume content from. Yeah. So I tried very hard to find criticisms of UBI. They were largely around three or four things. One, people are going to while away their money on booze and drugs, which again was disproved. Second, people will not do anything. My point is, if people want to do nothing, let them sit and do nothing. The economy will find a way to make life happen, right?
Yeah.
My life is not going to change in any way because you have chosen to chosen to do nothing. And, you know, all our petty things like this, which have all been disproved. To me, one of the most hilarious examples, and I'm sad to say who criticized this, was Kevin O'Leary from Shark Tank, the bald guy who criticized and usually makes some very rational argument, if controversial statements. In one video, it was basically, I think Kevin O'Leary says why UBI won't work or something. And he just said UBI will not work. That's it.
Period.
And then... It will not work. Whatever. If you think other people will be happy funding you, sitting on your couch and, you know, just watching, you got another thing coming, stuff like that. And then suddenly the video took a senti turn when he said, you know, my mom, supported me when I was through college. After that, I became successful. And then went on another track altogether. I'm wondering what the connect was. And down there, the first comment and the most popular comment was, so basically what you're saying is, your mom gave you UBI till you were old enough and, you know, smart enough to make money on your own. So I think that just summed up the whole thing.
Yeah.
That was a beautiful
Learity check.
Yeah. So that's all that we have for you, dear listener. If you have any thoughts on UBI, please send it to
Zuckerberg.
Zuckerberg at Gmail. What? Something. No, actually, no. Just ping it to us. We will not create that email ID. Thank you all for tuning in. Thank you, Shriket, for being there for half the episode. Thank you, Naren, for being there for the other half. Thank you, Tony. I don't think we have ever thanked each other on the show. So thank you for being
here. We are being magnanimous in giving everyone money. We can money give thanks also.
Praise. Yeah,
so
praise is still free. Yeah, you can't spell raise without praise, as they say. Naren, please end this before.
Stay safe. Stay
universal.
Stay universal. Stay basic and compact. And stay simplified.
Filter coffee is a fascinating beverage. You need to pick the right beans, blend them in the right proportion, roast them to perfection, and slow brew at the right temperature to get the perfect cup. Which is exactly like great conversations as well. You need to track down the most interesting minds, get them into their zone, and settle down for an unhurried, unscripted chat. And coffee for me is always, always, always best enjoyed with friends. I'm Karthik Nagarajan, and do share my table as I meet some of the most interesting people I know and sit them down for a strong cup of coffee and an even stronger conversation. Join me every Wednesday for a freshly brewed episode. This is not Frappe. This is the Filter Coffee Podcast.
How many times have you caught yourself Googling stuff on health and wondering if it's the right information? How many times have you heard different health experts give opposing views, which has only left you confused? There are rising cases of cancer, heart, diabetes, stress, and autoimmune diseases. Meet the patients and the experts who paved the path of true healing. Join me, Rachna Chachi, cancer nutrition coach and nutritional therapist on Heal and Hearty. I take you through my own journey of recovery from an incurable disease and the journey of so many others who healed only via nutrition and holistic healing. Find the answers you seek for what's good for your health and what's good for your soul. You can listen to us on the IVM Podcast app or ivmpodcast.com. Don't forget your date with good health.